So in week one, we are going to cover one-dimensional motion, that is the motion of a particle or mass or an object along one dimension, which may be horizontal, which may be vertical, but essentially the particle is moving along a certain direction. And we will essentially explore questions around two scenarios. First scenario, in which the acceleration is changing with time. And here we will use our definition of instantaneous velocity and acceleration, A is equal to dv by dt, and see how we use these concepts in different applications. And then we will look at motion with constant acceleration. Constant acceleration, acceleration is constant. That means the velocity is changing at a constant rate. Here, we will primarily see how we can use the two independent kinematic equations or their variations. So what are those two independent kinematic equations? V is equals to u plus at and y is equals to ut plus half at squared. So we will explore how we can use these two equations in different scenarios. So let's take a quick dive into variable acceleration and see in how many different ways can this concept be used. So let's see. So in the first question type, we will look at a very simple scenario wherein the position or velocity of a particle is given as a function of time. That means we are given either x as a function of time or we are given v as a function of time. And in case we are given position of particle as a function of time, then we might be asked to determine the velocity of the particle as a function of time or the acceleration as a function of time, where essentially we will use derivative differentiation to obtain our expressions for velocity and accelerations. Or if we are given, say, acceleration, in which case we can use integration to determine velocity or position. In the second question type, we will look at different applications of speed v versus time graph. V versus time graph, quite an interesting and useful graph. From this graph, we can find out the acceleration of the particle at any point in time, or we can find the displacement of the particle by determining the area under the curve. In the third question type, we will look at scenarios where acceleration A would be given to us as a function of time t. A would be given as a function of time t. And as we discussed earlier, we can integrate at with respect to time and determine our expression for vt. And from there, we can determine our expression for position as needed or as asked in the problem or question. In the fourth question type, we might be given acceleration A as a function of position x. Now here, we will not be able to use straight away our relations A is equals to dv by dt or v is equals to dx by dt. Because in these expressions, we have time. And what we are given is A as a function of x. So we'll need to eliminate time from these equations and get A by v is equals to dv by dx. So now we have a relation in which time is not present, and that will allow us to determine the unknown. Now in the fifth question type, you might be given acceleration A as a function of velocity v. A might be given as a function of velocity v. In which case, you can straight away use the standard definition A is equals to dv by dt. And if you slightly readjust the terms, you can get dt is equals to dv by av. Now, as you might notice, the right-hand side is purely a function of v and the left-hand side is purely a function of time t. And I would recommend that you refer to the detailed lecture video on each of these question type, wherein we will deep dive into the concepts and we'll take up a sample problem that will help you understand how we go about applying the concepts to solving problems. Now, in the second scenario under one-dimensional motion, we will be given or will be dealing with scenarios where the acceleration is constant acceleration is constant. That is, the rate of change of velocity is constant, is not changing with time. So here we will essentially examine four different types of scenarios or question types. So in the first question type, under the constant acceleration, we'll simply learn to apply v is equals to u plus at and displacement x is equals to ut plus half at squared to determine the unknown. And these will be fairly simple, straightforward questions. I would still recommend that you go ahead and listen to the question type and look at some of the sample problems that we have discussed there. Now, in the second question type under constant acceleration, instead of giving you the three of the five kinematic variables, so which are those five I'm talking about? The final velocity, the initial velocity, the acceleration, time, and displacement. Remember that we have only two independent kinematic equations, which means we can only solve for two unknowns. So we need to know the other three, which will be provided to you in the given problem. Now, the examiners, instead of giving you these kinematic variables, information about three of them at the initial and final point, instead of giving them only at the initial and final point, you will be given information about some intermediate point during the journey. So here you just have to patiently work through your standard kinematic equations and you will find the unknown. By the way, it is important to point out that v square is equals to u square plus 2as is another very handy kinematic equation that you should get very comfortable with. Now let's look at the third question type, wherein the particle might be undergoing change in direction. So once again, in question type number two, the particle is moving in one direction only, right? So what is the implication? What is the difference between question type two and question type three? Well, in question type two, the velocity and acceleration, their relative directions do not change. So if the particle is coming down under the force of gravity, then v and g are both in the same direction. And if the particle was moving upwards, then v and g would be in opposite direction for the entire of the journey. But in question type 3, where the particle reverses direction, you have to make sure, first of all, that you choose a convenient frame of reference, which means you clearly define that in your frame of reference, the positive y-axis or positive x-axis is pointed either upward or downwards, whatever is convenient or comfortable for you. But make sure that you stick with that origin and the coordinate axes. And make sure that when you're writing the equations, the kinematic equations for the two journeys, journey going up and journey in the other direction, make sure that you correctly account for the signs of velocity and acceleration. Now in the fourth question type, the particle is undergoing motion along one dimension, but the acceleration is different for different segments. So if we take a look at this picture, between this duration, the particle is moving under constant acceleration A1. In second duration or second segment of its journey, it is moving under zero acceleration, and then under the third one, it's moving at a different but constant acceleration. So the equation, the kinematic equation that we have to write, v is equals to u plus at, or the displacement is equals to ut plus half at squared, you have to write them for each individual segments. And at these points, you just need to make sure that when you're transitioning from writing your equations from one segment to the other, that you make sure that your velocities and the timestamps match. If the last part did not make sense, I would recommend that you listen to the lecture video and look at the sample problem as well.